Ian Rush took centre stage at the racecourse ground. The 37-year-old has joined Wrexham as player coach, and he clearly enjoyed himself as Reading's expensively assembled squad was blown away. Carl Connolly were the opener. The Dutch keeper, Peter van der Kwak, had one of those afternoons he'd rather forget. 5 minutes into the second half, Andy Legg's back pass should have been comfortably cleared, but the Dutch keeper completely missed his kick. Visiting manager Tommy Burns has spent a small fortune rebuilding this side. On this evidence, he has some way to go. Peter Ward with Wrexham's third, and Ian Rush was off to a winning start.
Yeah, I think it was tremendous. You know, it was a great turnout, and I'm really happy, you know, that they all turned out to watch. Not just me, but also the team. Would have been nice to get a goal from, really, but every time I made my debut, I've never scored on my debut, so I didn't disappoint today.
Bristol Rovers Reading next. Commentary comes from Phil Duffel.
Nice turn by McIntyre. He's away from Andreasen. Into the middle for Williams. And Reading score with their first meaningful attack of the game. 6 minutes gone. Martin Williams puts the visitors in front. Signs are promising though. And Roberts has gone down under the challenge. Penalty kick, says referee Ryder, and the Dutchman Elroy Cromier is the guilty man. Well, Curitan's been in good goal scoring form, but he's missed it again, and Rovers are not making the most of their chances from 12 yards. Curitan, he'll be desperate to atone for that miss. He may just about do so. He's found Hales, chance for Rovers. Barry Hales, the goal machine, is underway once more. This is Foster. Hales with Parkinson for company. Great turn. Super save. Mika! And Rovers lead. And Michael Mika. Well, you can tell how much he enjoyed that particular moment. Back in from Chalice. That fall now for Foster. Deflected away, the referee has said penalty kick again. Once more, it's Curitan against van der Clark. This time, Curitan wins the battle, and Rovers lead 3-1. Nicely directed header by Chalice, he did well to find Curitan. Forward for Hales, it's Roberts with a chance. In off the post, Jason Roberts completes the afternoon's work for Bristol Rovers. His first goal for the club.
I would like to think that that will stand us in good stead. Certainly not nice to take and nice to experience, but I think I can look back at the two games against Wrexham and today against Bristol Rovers and see that there was a lack of enthusiasm to play the game, which is very disappointing at any level. But, you know, I've got to take it as a club. We'll take the criticism as a club and we'll take the praise as a club. But over the piece, we've lost 7 goals, and basically, I think about 6 of them have been down to defensive errors. So that's very, very disappointing.
And welcome to a slightly shorter south today from arguably the best football stadium in the country. Now, whatever view you have of it, it is spectacular. We took these pictures only a few hours ago, a stadium you cannot miss. Well, inside, last-minute preparations have been going on throughout the course of the afternoon. The dots have been put on the I's, not to mention one or two of the J's as well. Tomorrow, Reading gets its Stadium of Dreams.
Let's now move on to sport. And while Saints, Pompey and Brighton are all struggling with plans for their new grounds, Reading has become the first football club in the South to build a new stadium. Final preparations are being carried out to make sure the £37 million stadium is ready for the first match tomorrow. John Medeski, the chairman with the millions who made it all possible, won't be there. But Harry tonight joins us from the touchline. Harry.
You know, I like watching my football in comfortable surroundings, and I have to say that that's why I enjoyed going to watch Huddersfield Town play so much. Wonderful stadium there. But I reckon that this one here at Reading is now better. Roger Johnson reports on Reading's £37 million dream.
A sporting oasis. Reading have succeeded where other South Coast football clubs have so far failed, and the region's first purpose-built stadium has been constructed to stringent new environmental guidelines. When it's complete, the site will also include a conference centre and hotel. The access routes also still have to be finished. It is without doubt the sporting jewel of the Thames Valley, and to repay some of the enormous development costs, Reading will allow Richmond Rugby Club to play their home games here. The stadium bears the name of the man who paid for most of the £37 million construction costs, but John Medeski won't be back in the country for some time. Business commitments and tax arrangements have kept him abroad, but 25,000 people will be here tomorrow.
Certainly no doubt that this place has captured the imagination of not just the fans and, as you know, nearly a sellout for tomorrow, but also from the commercial business point of view.
The finishing touches have all been put in place today. The stadium safety certificate was granted just after 4 o'clock. All 28 hospitality boxes have been sold. Now everyone's hoping the Royals can christen their new home with a win.
Here, here. Well, with me now is the manager, Tommy Burns. Lovely surroundings. You've got to start winning, Tommy.
Yeah, that's right. That's the whole point of the thing. It's no use building a stadium like this if you're losing football matches.
But, of course, you've got the surroundings now to really perform well, hopefully.
Yeah, that's right. I think, you know, it's obviously it takes a wee bit of time to get a team performing the way you want to. And we've had our fair share of injuries since the start of the season, but I think every club has that, so you just have to put up with that. No excuses, but we know it will turn around.
Now, Nigel, tomorrow, 25,000 people. There's going to be a tremendous atmosphere here, isn't there?
Yeah, I mean, it's just going to be, you know, probably the best event ever for Reading, I would have thought, in the history, certainly in the history of the football club. And I mean, people are going to be so keen to see what it's like, what it's all about, and I hope and I'm sure they'll be pleased.
Obviously it's disappointing that the chairman's not here, but he is here in spirit in every sense of the word, I suspect.
Yeah, well, I speak to him most days. I don't know whether that's good or bad, but in fact I do, and he's always asking me what's going on, and we sent him pieces of the carpet and pictures of the stadium, so he knows what's going on.
Which is going to be the home end, do you think, in the end, Tommy? Which will the fans regard as their end, if you understand, like the cop end or whatever?
Well, hopefully if there's 24,000, 25,000 come tomorrow, we can keep them here. Yeah. If that's the case, then the whole stadium will be the home end.
Do you think you prefer kicking towards that end?
Yeah, well, whatever end we can get a go on.
Tommy Burns, Nigel Howe, thank you very much indeed for joining us. Well, as well as ourselves, Thames Valley FM will have full coverage of tomorrow's grand opening, with reports on the build-up in the morning and commentary on the game itself in Saturday Sport between 2 and 6.
They came in their thousands by car, by bus and on foot to Britain's newest football venue. The first game at the Medeski Stadium produced the right result, victory for Reading, but it did leave transport chiefs with a few headaches. The predicted road chaos wasn't as bad as expected, but lessons were learnt. Today, club officials met with police and councillors to discuss ways of improving travel delays. Juliet Fletcher has the latest.
Fans turned up in their droves for the opening game at Reading's brand new Medeski Stadium. Over 20,000 people converged on the town to see Reading get off to a winning start against Luton. But while things all ran smoothly inside the stadium, the sheer number of people converging on the site meant problems outside. Six special bus services were laid on and a shuttle bus carried people to and from the station every 15 minutes. But still the queues grew and grew as the buses struggled to meet demand.
It was very difficult. There were queues for about, I'd say, a mile in the town centre. They queued all the way from the bus stop all the way up to McDonald's, and so we got a taxi in the end.
Got into the station and the queue was right into town, so we phoned her mum up.
She'd give us a lift.
Good old mum.
It's not too bad. There's plenty of buses, a bit full up, but maybe we should come early next time.
Well, it was inevitable there were going to be queues because of the sheer number of people that needed to get to the match, and so they had to wait a little while, but we had some of our controllers going up and down the queue assuring people that they would get a bus and that we would get them to the match on time.
The traffic in the town centre wasn't as bad as predicted. About 10,000 people drove to the match. Others caught buses, taxis or even walked. But kick-off was still delayed by 15 minutes due to hold-ups on the M4 and the A33. Managers at the club have recognised there are lessons to be learned from Saturday's match. Today they met with police and councillors to discuss ways of improving the transport situation.
Bearing in mind this was a 20,000 plus crowd, I think generally everybody thought it went quite well. In future we will review the number of buses and the number of, certainly the number of shuttle buses that will go from the town centre. Those will be increased substantially in line with the crowd.
It was a good result for the Royals, and club managers are confident any problems will be ironed out in time for the next match on Wednesday. Juliet Fletcher in Reading for Meridian Tonight.
by the way. Stay tuned because you can see the goals later in the programme.
But first, Reading launched a new era in the club's history with a memorable victory over Luton. The squad still has plenty to achieve, but they began life at the Madejski Stadium with a convincing victory. Chris Moore reports on the 3-0 win against Luton.
The Royal Air Force parachute team, appropriately dressed in blue and white, hit the ground running. And fortunately, on this notable day in the history of sport in the Thames Valley, so did Tommy Byrne's new-look side. Just 10 minutes into its working life, the stadium's first goal went to 20-year-old Grant Brebner. He joined Reading from Manchester United in the summer. Reading's biggest home crowd for 20 seasons discovered a new hero. Liberian Massar set up Jim McIntyre's chance. And then McIntyre returned the compliment. The pace of the former Monaco striker was upsetting Luton. Dutch goalkeeper Peter van der Kwaak has endured an uneasy start with Reading, but he made amends with a double save to keep Luton at bay. In the second half, Reading produced a counter-attack with a memorable conclusion. Ray Houghton exchanged passes with McIntyre and then brought in Saar. A precise ball from him was finished by McIntyre. It was a goal worthy of the venue. Near the end, Reading wrapped it up with a third. Darren Caskey supplied the telling pass and substitute Robert Fleck did the rest. 15 months of hard work building the ground had been capped by a good day's work on the field of play.
I'm very pleased for the chairman, because I know how much it meant to him to kick off with a winning start. And most importantly, pleased for the supporters.
It was great. It was fantastic. I want to come out every Sunday or every Saturday or every Wednesday and do my best. I just got back 2 days ago from a national team game, and I was kind of tired, you know. So I wanted to come out here and do my best, but I was kind of tired in the second half, and I had my hamstring tight, so I decided to leave the game.
Even if the journey home was difficult, the result made it more bearable. Chris Morn at the Madejski Stadium for Meridian tonight.
A great victory for Reading, but
after four games, it seemed that Chesterfield can't win away but can't lose at home. Reading was sent packing as John Howard scored the only goal of the game at Saltergate.
Macclesfield chalked up a first home win as Sammy McElroy saw his team respond positively to the thrashing at the hands of Birmingham. Mike Holt on his debut with their first goal. Reading manager Tommy Byrne just can't win away. He was forced to field a makeshift side, but at least barring Glasgow's pace, won the team a penalty. Glasgow upended, Martin Williams stepped up to bring the score level. Stuart Whittaker, who'd been dropped to the substitutes bench, set up Macclesfield's winning goal. One inviting centre was all it needed, and John Askey's measured header won the game. A second straight defeat for Stoke, but they stay top of the table. Manager Brian Little, though, will be concerned by his strikers' failure to convert simple goal-scoring opportunities. Reading, who've spent big in the pursuit of glory, are at last showing signs of improvement. Manager Tommy Burns has been under increasing pressure to turn things round. The club remain unbeaten at their new Majeski Stadium. Grant Brednell helped them to a second win in 4 days, that just seconds before the break. Stoke's second-half reply came from Justin Little. They were lining up at the far post to head that one in. Little accused his players of lacking real passion. They have a week off. That time will be used on the training pitch to get back to basics. Reading's winner came 17 minutes from time. Jimmy Crawford's cross headed in by the Scottish under-21 international Jim McIntyre, who was back from injury. Stoke had chances of their own to level the score. Once again, they were wasteful in front of goal. Kyle Lightbourne and Peter Thorne, the two chief culprits. Reading are creeping towards mid-table respectability. They have a game in hand on all but one of the teams above them.
Gillingham looking for a win at Reading weren't short on effort. A corner found John Hodge, whose on-target header brought out the keeper's best. The following corner nearly brought a result as well, albeit from the head of a Reading player, but it went straight to safe hands. Reading tried to break the deadlock with a cracking shot from Williams, but it was well kept out by Vince Bartram's sharp reflexes. A disappointing goalless draw then, a Reading nil, Gillingham nil.
Test for City's defensive qualities. A corner kick from the Reading left. Williams with the flick, and Martin Williams has put Reading ahead, and doesn't he look pleased?
It needed three pitch inspections before this first ever league meeting between these clubs was given the go-ahead by the inconsistent match official Clive Wilkes. Grant Brednell scored twice in the opening 9 minutes, both goals created by the former Spurs player Darren Caskey, although that free kick was hotly disputed. The second, again from a Caskey set piece, the ball eventually finding its way through to the Scottish under-21 striker, Wycombe further behind. The division's bottom club could have buckled, but to their credit, they responded positively. Visiting keeper Scott Howie allowing Matthew Lawrence's header to slip between his legs. Tommy Burns' Reading team have recovered well after a dreadful start to the campaign, which left the manager's job on the line. They've certainly found their form of late. Martin Williams' headed goal, 19 minutes from the end, appeared enough for victory. A minute later, though, there was only one goal to separate these two rivals. Jason Cousins brought it back to 3-2, and for Reading, it was now about preserving the slenderest of leads. They managed to hold on, but in a frantic final few minutes, as tempers flared, Wickham's Nicky Moen was red-carded for that reckless challenge, and this match ended on a sour note.
Cobbler still in the bottom four, and desperate now that points start to be picked up as Hunter puts a great shot in. Just over the top from the Cobblers, number seven. Frayne. Good cross in from Frayne. Headed goalwards, but saved by Scott Howie. Christian Lee, the man with the header. Now Reading threatening the Cobblers. They look pretty impressive at the moment. This is Caskey. That's a good ball forward into the box for the Cobblers. Williams taps it back to Caskey. I'm not sure if he meant to do that, but it proved effective. And Grant Brebner puts Reading 1-0 ahead. Cobblers now fighting back, trying to get this equaliser. That's not a bad effort. That really was a good effort. Just pushed wide from Savage.
Into December, and another game dominated by Millwall without due reward. Lucas Neal set them on the right road with a low 20-yarder. but shoddy defensive work was again to prove Millwall's undoing, and Mas Sarr refused to look this particular gift horse in the mouth. One won the final score.
They've got to roll their sleeves up and put some fire in their belly, said Oldham boss Andy Ritchie after the Walsall defeat 7 days earlier. But the seven Latics defenders in and around the six-yard box didn't pick up Jim McIntyre, the Scots' first for 2.5 months. It was much more what Ritchie wanted after the break, though. Mark Allott's fourth league goal of the season, finishing off a move of splendid quality. Reading 1, Oldham 1.
On the 28th of December 1998, the Royals had a Christmas home fixture against Notts County. Reading fielded players such as Elroy Cromhear in the centre-back position, on the left midfield Byron Glasgow, and in goal it was Scott Howie for the Royals. The first chance fell to County after a corner. The ball comes out to Murray and he fires in a long-range shot. Scott Howie tips it over the bar. Good save, and it wasn't to be his last of the day. And Reading onto the attack. Grant Brebner in midfield with Darren Caskey. Good ball through to Paul Brayson. Chance inside the area, but the flag had gone up. Looks like a harsh decision. Paul Brayson flagged offside. Caskey again in midfield, the playmaker for Reading. Spreads it wide to Byron Glasgow. Deep cross from him, and it's Brayson inside the area again on the stretch. Couldn't gather it first time. And then the shot into the side netting. Paul Brayson struggling for goals at this point in his Reading career. In fact, he struggled from throughout his Reading career. Off target there. County on the attack, and another good save from Scott Howie on that occasion. Long ball, half headed away, drops on the edge of the area, and Howie saves it. The corner comes in, Howie comes to the cross, can't gather, and on the turn, there's Grant, fires it against the crossbar, and it's cleared somehow from the Royals. Number 8, Notts County, winning the header on the edge. There was Andy Hughes, you may have noticed, in the Magpies lineup, but it was Grant who came close to scoring the opener. Halfway through the first half, long kick from Howie, header from Richardson, 1-0 from Reading. Ian Richardson, a quite shocking own goal, and that's given Reading the lead. Comical scenes, really. Long punt, Richardson showed great awareness, knew he was being closed down from behind, the keeper was off his line, headed it over him. Unfortunately, it was his own keeper, so Reading have the lead. Darren Caskey tries something even more spectacular a few minutes later. Over the crossbar with that one, though. Then County, the ball comes in, chested down by Grant. Looking for Andy Hughes, and the shot comes in against the post. So nearly a goal there for Andy Hughes against his future club. Into the second half, Neil Clement on the charge for Reading. Lone player from Chelsea, does well, cuts it back. Phil Parkinson in the middle, and it's just scrambled away. Danger not over yet, though, until Elroy Cromhear concedes possession. But good chance from Phil Parkinson. But what's he doing there? On the edge of the six-yard box, Parky with a left-footed drive. I can assure you it's true. Another chance for Clement to come forward. Good ball releases Grant Brebner down the left. Cross from him. Headed away as far as Byron Glasgow with the shot on the half volley. Not a bad effort from Byron, whose only Reading goal was to come in the return fixture at Meadow Lane later in the season, but it was wide on this occasion. Now Neil Clement for Reading. Long ball over the top. The offside flag doesn't go up, and Brebner's able to surge away. Cross looking for Brayson. Darren Ward less than convincing in the County goal before eventually he whacks it high into the east stand. Not very convincing, though. Another attack from Reading. Caskey. It's half cleared and eventually whacked away by the County defender for a corner. Very nearly a spectacular own goal there as he smashes it into the stanchion. And Tommy Burns making his point on the sideline. Soon after that, there was a very entertaining interlude. Of course, we can't condone this sort of thing. But a streaker came onto the pitch. Black leather jacket and socks. But other than that, not a lot. Had time to prance around. And look at that body swerve. Left the steward stranded. Great play. And then he jumps up the steps. Steward's in hot pursuit. Comical scenes, really. Three of them pursue him into the concourse, and I don't really know what happened in there, to be honest. Play resumed. Reading on the attack. Good ball over the top. Brayson
fires in the cross, and the county substitute Strodder, who came on for Andy Hughes, just able to turn it away for a corner. Then Darren Caskey's corner. Parkinson heads on, and Brayson nods it into the net, but it's disallowed very harshly, it seems. McIntyre not happy with the referee, Rob Stiles, and you can see why. It doesn't seem that Parkinson did too much wrong. Brayson certainly didn't do anything wrong, but the goal didn't count. Still Reading look for the second goal. Caskey sees the run of McIntyre. Lovely ball in for Jim McIntyre. His cross cleared by Dennis Pearce. As far as Parkinson, smashes in the shot. Good save by Ward. Then it comes back in again, and Glasgow over the crossbar. Reading really should have scored there. Byron Glasgow with the second opportunity, 8 yards out. And look at that. Should have found the target really, Byron Glasgow. But it remains 1-0. And County not finished yet. Ball comes in from the throw-in, and it's Grant, given space, gets a shot in, but Howie with another good save, diving away to his right. Good strong hand to turn that round for a corner. So still Reading lead by a goal to nil. The corner comes in. Again, Howie comes, doesn't make contact, and Strodder from almost inside the goal somehow manages to turn it over the bar. Reading forced to defend more at this stage. But a good breakaway here. Lovely ball from McIntyre to Paul Brayson. Brayson looking for the shot, but then goes back for Parkinson. His cross. Brebner helps it back to Brayson again. Now out to Jimmy Crawford. Looking for support from the right back maybe, but Jimmy Crawford was the right back. So he has to settle on a pass back to Parkinson. Then Brayson again. Turned in for Caskey. Good chip from him. Brebner with the header. But he was just stretching on that. And Darren Ward able to make the save as Brebner couldn't direct it past him. Another chance for County to come forward, and it's Ian Hendon with the cross. Turned goalwards by Grant, but what a great save from Scott Howie. Probably the best of the match. You see that on the replay. Excellent save. Reflexes from Scott Howie to turn it away with his left hand. Now Neil Clement, who say on loan from Chelsea for the Royals, intercepting, and a good ball into the middle. Paul Brayson. Saved by Ward. Brayson maybe just delaying the shot a little bit and giving Ward an opportunity to come out and smother it. Another chance for County. Header. And Howie under the crossbar tips it over. That was the last significant action. So the Royals win this game by 1-0 thanks to Richardson's own goal.
He doesn't set up many goals with his head, but this perfect pass allowed Curitan to open the scoring. A masterly nod down from the player-manager, and perhaps it wasn't going to be such a bad day for Curitan after all. With David Lee imposing himself on midfield, Rovers' self-belief increased by the minute, and Mark McKeever was next to show up Reading's suspect back line. A mazy dribble from the lone signing, and almost a goal to remember. McKeever was also behind the move that brought Rovers a 57th minute penalty. His cross was controlled by Roberts, who then had to take on two defenders. They were more interested in wrestling than playing football, giving referee Barry Knight an easy decision. Perhaps two penalties should have been awarded, as Darren Caskey and Neil Clement both committed fouls at the same time. Curitan had to make do with one spot kick, and nonchalantly made it 2-0. Reading developed a bad case of the jitters, and Curitan's hat-trick soon followed. Suicidal defending, but a finish right out of the top drawer. A moment of good fortune with the ricochet, but the little striker was confident enough to shoot early and struck his effort perfectly. Curitan could simply do no wrong. It seemed wherever he went, the ball was likely to follow, and the outcome was inevitable. 4-0, and number 16 of the season for a player often confined to the flank positions. Again, the deflection fell perfectly, and Curitan wasn't going to miss from 3 yards. Now it was time for a little midfield wizardry. The final touch wasn't perfect, but Lee managed to make it into another scoring chance. With Rovers fans taunting their former player, Trevor Challis was next to let fly from distance. Goalkeeper Lee Jones had been a virtual spectator during the Rovers' spree, but when called into action by Phil Parkinson, he was ready to play his part. Now Cureton was to turn goal maker, as his pace again left Reading floundering. Roberts looked sure to be crowded out, but this was a day when anything was possible for Rovers strikers. Three defenders on hand to clear, but by now Reading boss Tommy Burns must have been reaching for the service revolver. Steve Foster's amazing vision led to Rovers' sixth goal. How about this for a defence-splitting pass? And just when Reading thought they'd dealt with it, up popped Roberts to complete a memorable victory. Sadly, he's no John Cleese when it comes to silly walks. There was barely time for demoralised Reading to kick off before Rovers were able to celebrate an astonishing 45 minutes. What a day for the massed ranks of travelling fans. Coach Gary Penrice was soon leading the applause for that following, who were only too glad to show their appreciation of a stunning second half.
And so to Notts County, who had lost five of their last six matches, that is, before today's home game with Reading.
Reading's record at Meadow Lane hasn't been too impressive in recent years, but if ever there was a time to improve it, today was it. Notts are on what's becoming a dangerous slide back towards Division 3. When Brian Glasgow scored for Reading, Notts manager Sam Allardyce's position was becoming as precarious as his team's. But Gary Owers made it 1-1, bringing Notts a precious point and Allardyce a bit more time.
Into town. The smallest man on the park, Dean Keats, applying the finishing touch. Route 1 or no Route 1, the Saddlers have got their promotion push back in the fast lane. Reading 0, Walsall 1.
6 points separate Reading and Burnley in mid-table. Reading have the advantage. They took the advantage at Turf Moor. Darren Caskey's goal came from a narrow angle and against the run of play. An equaliser was the least that Burnley deserved. Lenny Johnrose made an impressive debut for the Clarets, but it was defender Brian Reid whose goal finally earned a share of the points. It came in the final minutes, 1-1. Luton.
When you've won seven of your last nine league matches and just taken over pole position in the table, you're entitled to start with a bit of a swagger. Steve Basham, two-goal hero for Preston on his debut last week, sent flying for what appeared an obvious penalty. The slow motion, not quite so clear card. But Scott Howie in the Reading goal would have had to deal with more searching back passes than Kurt Nogan's spot kick. Watch the Reading defenders encroaching inside the box though. It should have been retaken. No need to retake Darren Caskey's opener for Reading. He got a beaut at Turf Moor last week. That's one for the home fans. No wonder they paid a record 700 grand for him. The Preston leveller was even better. Steve Basham, the on-loan saint, haunting Scott Howie once again. If he does that every week, he'll be back at the Dell in no time. But Darren Caskey wasn't about to play second fiddle to anyone. And when Sean Gragan scythed him over in stoppage time, another on-loan man, Tony Thorpe, had to take over penalty duties. That's cool. Very cool. Reading 2, Preston 1.
Phil Parkinson looking for
his forwards, and it may yet come across in danger here as Simon stepped back, and there's a chance, and it's an early goal for Reading. Well, Hales can seize on the opportunity. Scott Howie gathers it quickly. Gray to Paulston. And Paulson's beaten now. Pesky Salido can start the second half beautifully for Fulham. Oh, he's hit the crossbar, would you believe it? The golden opportunity. And now Fulham immediately follow it up with a corner. Hayward looks long towards Simons. Almost finding his fellow centre-back. No offside given. Hayward! Horsfield indeed, sorry, not Hayward. Horsfield continues his scoring run, and that was a tremendous bit of skill from the big man. And Fulham straight back into it 2 minutes into the second half. Hayward then. Hits it low. Albert, might be again, Horsfield's on it again! It's just the start that was required in the second half. Turns, hits, unmarked. Great stuff from Horsfield. Hit long, again the goalkeeper's missed it, and it's in the back of the net. And Kit Simons is claiming it. Coleman it was with the header. Whoever it is, it's 3-1.
Reading have recently been granted a wedding licence at the Majewski Stadium, but after just one win in the last eight, not much confetti has been flying about on the field. That may change after Darren Caskey's third stunning goal in the last five matches. He's flying. Reading 1, Macclesfield 0.
A year ago this weekend was the last time Bournemouth lost at home. There must be something about middle March that causes such novel events. Mark McKeever gave the Cherries a taste of things to come. Reading's victory was owed in part to keeper Scott Howie and this magnificent double save. Jamie Vincent and Ian Cox were the players denied, and there were appeals that Cox's header had crossed the line, but the ref said no, and the score remained Coxless. It was just left for McKeever to grab the game's only goal, his second in two games on loan from Sheffield Wednesday, to keep Reading's playoff hopes flickering and inflict that rare home defeat on Bournemouth. Bournemouth 0, Reading 1.
If Wycombe manager Laurie Sanchez hoped for any favours from one of his old clubs, he was disappointed. Jason Cousins' mistake allowed Jim McIntyre to set Reading on the way to their fourth consecutive win. 6 minutes before the break, the bottom club were thrown a lifeline. Andy Baird seems sure to score until Andy Burnell's intervention, a tackle that Reading's tenants Richmond Rugby Club would have been happy with. Burnell sent off, much to the disbelief of keeper Scott Howie. He found the referee's decision far more upsetting than the penalty, Dave Carroll's effort woefully high and wide. The 10 men battened down the hatches, putting an extra defender on in place of a striker, but still managed one more fruitful foray forward, 17 minutes from the end. Stuart Gray's overlap and an unstoppable header from Darren Caskey. Wycombe did end the day with the distinction of being the first side to score against Reading in almost a month. Sean Devine's goal was a cracker, but with their second division future now seriously in peril, no consolation for Wycombe.
Given to the Hatters, but Graham Alexander, before he departed Luton Town, missed it. The team were in 14th place for the second division at this stage of the season. It's a nice build-up play. And what a scramble goal, eventually just bundled home by Matthew Spring. Luton look to try and get back can secure all 3 points in the game for the first time after 4 defeats on the spin. The Royals got a lucky card hand dealt to them. Well worked, and a stooping, powerful header meant that it was 1-1. It was a game.
Half an hour gone then. Free kick to City. Here's Cook. Cook curls the ball in. Oh, what a goal from Terry Cook. Reminiscent of his Old Trafford teammate David Beckham. But Cook's done the business for his new club, Manchester City. Appeals for handball. Play on, says the referee. And that means City can move forward on the attack. They've made an impressive start to this second half. And they could get a second goal here. Sean Gota against the goalkeeper, through his legs. And the big Bermudan striker has grabbed the goal and the glory. Well, Cook's got one from a free kick. Can he do it again? Yes, he can! Terry Cook gets his second goal of the game. And suddenly, the man on loan from Old Trafford is the darling of the City supporters. Reading comprehensively beaten on their own pitch, looking for a consolation goal. Nicky Weaver will want to keep a clean sheet. He could be struggling here, though. That slip by Vikings, and Weaver is beaten. Reading get the goal, but it's too late.
Reading came to Preston to take on Gillingham. The Gills were 5 points above Reading in Division 2. The game finished Gillingham 2, Reading 1. Carlos Arba scoring the winner in the 64th minute. That result...
Forward come Reading again. A good ball through, and Scott's on his own here. Trouble for Fulham. Scott into the area. A great save from Taylor. Mike Taylor doing the business. Kevin Keegan not happy. Trollope with the free kick. Come through a crowd of players, and there's Simon Morgan right at the back of that crowd of players to just knock it past Howie. How it came to him, I'm not sure, but there he was, and Fulham have the lead.
Hunt's corner, or just flicked behind for another corner now to the Cobblers. John Frayne to take this corner now on the far side. And it comes, headed goalwards, and the final touch makes it 1-0 to Northampton Town. Savage the scorer, and it could prove priceless.
Wigan's Paul Rogers must feel goals are a little bit like London buses. He's found only one all season, but after last Sunday's injury time winner at Wembley, there he was again on Saturday, booking his ticket to leave Reading in arrears. Mathematically, Wigan can still claim the second promotion place, especially as they plunder plenty of goals. This one owed much to Andy Liddell's pass and the ability of Stuart Barlow to be in the right place at the right time. It's been a productive season for the former Everton and Oldham striker, and when he lobbed in another just 9 minutes on, that made it number 23 for him. Reading's collapse in recent weeks has been agonising for their fans, and they derived little satisfaction from this trip north, despite a neatly taken header by Andy McLaren. If Wembley was a red-letter day in the career of veteran Colin Greenall, well, he's not willing to put on the carpet slippers just yet, and he's signed off Wigan's latest win with the final goal.
Reading halted a run of 8 matches without a win by beating Millwall in a mid-table encounter at the Medeski. They took the lead through Phil Parkinson. And Stuart Gray added a second. It's 4 league games without a win now for Millwall. Reading 2, Millwall 0.
I'm wondering that you would love to get an early goal.
however it would come, however scrappily, it would do them a wonderful amount of good. Reed's challenge, no falls, and the deflection goes in after Mark Innes gets his first of the season. Well, what a start! The atmosphere is here, and Oldham have got the perfect tonic for it, with a goal 5 minutes in from their little master, Mark Innes. It was a dangerous header that both those two players went for. Receives a standing ovation, the Oldham captain, who's played his part of Oldham to escape today, even if he manages to leave this game just 10 minutes in. And they're being paid back because of it. Bernal. Matt Houghton, who's fancying his chances. Oh, what a save from Gary Kelly! Finds Beavers, who in turn finds Innes, and there's Paul Rickers with the second. Oh, precision goal, and Latics have covered their lead. Paul Rickers with his third of the season, and what a time to come up with it after some great work from Innes and a wonderful ball in.